Good afternoon. Good evening now. Good evening. This is I think second semester. Today third lecture. No? What did you did in the morning and thereafter? Taxation and this is financial reporting issues. So this is also one of the major subject in your accounting stream, people. And last semester actually we discussed something about basic accounting and we covered some accounting standards. So now this semester we are going to cover some IASs and IFRSs together with some IFRICs, and we will do some group accounts and set of financial instruments also. Right now, if you look the course outline first to have a kind of understanding about the course content, this is about financial reporting issues actually. Financial reporting issues means we are going to learn something about financial reporting plus what are the gray areas in financial reporting. Right, accordingly now the problem is already we have learned only basic type of accounting plus part of financial reporting. We did the several standards last semester. I think we didn't do leasing and we didn't do intangibles. We didn't do no intangibles. We did right, fine. Then we didn't do leasing. Yeah. And in first semester actually we did IAS 2, IAS 1, 8, 10, 16, 37, and 18 revenue also we did, no? 18. So some basic reporting requirements already we have covered in first semester, and hope you did your exam well. And we'll see anyway. Now I finalized assignment results and given, so probably it will be published by tomorrow or day after tomorrow. Right now. When it comes to this subject, this is little actually different subject compared to the previous one. In the previous one, we little learned about basic accounting plus some aspects of financial reporting. So now here actually we are going to learn some financial reporting issues. Right? Actually now, even though the syllabus is fully on financial reporting issues, we have not covered some aspects of financial reporting. Therefore, what I try to do now, I'll take some important aspects of financial reporting plus we will discuss some gray areas in financial reporting, right? So that's what I'm going to discuss today, sorry, within this semester. And if you look this course outline, you'll have some midterm evaluations. We can have information later. Anyway, all information is given in the course outline. Myself and Mudit will do this lecture this semester. And first week, actually, I'm going to do kind of introduction plus human resource accounting also. Even though I have scheduled it in the second week, the first week part already I have discussed. If you can remember, last semester we discussed something about elements, financial statements. So therefore, this semester I don't want to discuss everything again. So then, I'll do only the important aspects in accounting. And IFRS 2, actually it's kind of important reporting requirement now, so therefore we will discuss something about share based payment, and we will discuss something about employee benefits, and Mudit will do integrated reporting and some other aspects are there. After 6th week we are going to discuss something about IFRICs. I told you last semester we do basic IASs and IFRSs, and at least few IFRICs will be covered in this semester. International Financial Reporting Interpretation Committee guidance. So then we will do some important IFRICs, so the practicable IFRICs, which are common. And there is financial instruments there again, since you have not learned before. So I expect to cover financial instrument part. Plus, we will do something about group financial statements, right? Group accounts. And finally, we do revision session. Then you can understand what we are trying to do. This is kind of different kind of subject. Actually, we need to go mainly based on case basis. Right? Right. So then that's all about course outline. So if you start with the introduction part, already I have done the introduction part in the first semester also. Because I gave kind of introduction to financial reporting. So I'll just recall your knowledge about financial report in first lecture or the last semester deliveries, and thereafter we'll start something about human resource accounting today. I'm going to cover two things because I don't want to spend more time on accounting framework, because even though syllabus says like that, because accounting framework we did in the first semester, you can remember. I told you accounting framework will provide basic foundation for all accounting standards. So therefore, this semester we are just trying to recall your understanding about accounting framework, and thereafter we can discuss something about human resource accounting. Right? It is kind of aspect or gray area. Also, we need to understand what is accounting issue. It's also important because you have to understand what is an account, what is accounting issue, or what do you mean by contemporary accounting issue. Or what do you mean by sometime financial reporting issue, or just what is accounting problem? That kind of thing we will understand today with a research article, right? So then just to make kind of introduction, so hope you know already last semester the full work we fully devoted to understand financial statements, right? Actually, if you can remember, Professor Jayamaha did very the basic level thing accounting to give kind of background, it is important. And thereafter, my role was to give kind of understanding related to financial reporting. So that's why we discussed several standards. Right? So then, with that, if you can remember, mainly we focus on accounting standards, right? And financial statements. So actually, accounting standards we use to provide guidance on preparation and presentation of financial statements. So then if you take accounting as kind of process, actually today I do a lecture by sitting on this seat. See, reason is I am not well today. So otherwise I had to cancel the lecture, right? So because I had another lecture from 12:15 to 3:15 previously. But then today anyway, we don't have big call today. Reason we do only kind of interaction plus human resource accounting. So then if you can remember, accounting is kind of process we as we learn in the last semester. And it basically provide information to stakeholders, to different stakeholders. Because if you can remember, when it comes to introduction session or the input side of the accounting process, we take all transactions and events as inputs. And if you can remember, I told you all transactions and events are affecting to five main elements. Those five main elements will be used to record the assets, liability, income, expenditure, equity in everything in financial accounting process with double entries. Then we had five double entries. Main five elements, transactions and events. Then we had five double entries in the process. And finally, we came into accounting output or financial statements, which contains income statement, statement of financial position, you can remember now, statement of cash flows, statement of owner's equity, and notes financial statements. So therefore, if you can remember, we learn individual objectives of each these component. So that's a point where we stop there. Right? We understood financial statement and we learn how to prepare financial statement for individual company. In this semester, actually, we are going to learn not only individual company, we are going to learn how to prepare financial statements for a group as well, right? So then if you take financial statements as main output in accounting, can you remember the same thing I discussed last semester also? There are some inherent limitations and contributions of financial statements. Can you remember last semester we learned, why do you need financial statement? Basically, all these same slides we use in first semester. I'm going to just recall everything within 1 hour maximum. Thereafter, we can go for the human resource accounting. Right? I use only 1 hour to discuss everything here. Then main contribution of financial statement is to provide information to various users. Right? So, but it is a main role of financial statements. But when it comes to achieving this objective of providing information, there are certain limitations of financial statements. You remember I told you, what are the limitations of financial statements? All financial statements are prepared on historical basis or cost basis. It's kind of inherent problem, and alternatively we have kind of a solution for this. That's why we do fair value adjustment. That's why we do revaluation adjustment as kind of alternative for this limitation. Also, I told you in the last semester also, most of the accounting standards are developed in developed capital markets, in IASB, you know. So therefore, actually, when it comes to developing countries, there are some inherent problems. Also, now as solution actually for the historical cost method, we have a solution called fair value method. This semester we learned fair value, and applying fair value also kind of inherent problem. And we'll see what are the problems later. And also we know different users are there. They are having different objectives. But we provide only one common financial set, one set of financial statement to achieve all their needs. So therefore, we have a question whether we can achieve or we can satisfy all needs of stakeholders. It's also kind of limitation that we have. Actually, now to each limitation that I mentioned here previously, we have set of alternative remedies, right? So then for the first one I told you, to avoid historical cost problem, we can go with revaluation model. We can revalue assets. If you can remember, we learned in LK 16 last semester. For then fair value problems, we have sort of guidance in IFRS 13, fair value. And to achieve different needs of different stakeholders, we provide accounting notes and attachments and annexures together with financial statements. As a result of all these, we can mitigate the impact of this limitation, inherent limitation of financial statements. But commonly what you can do, if you make more disclosures through your financial statements, you can avoid your problems of financial statements. It's one requirement. Also, you can comply with accounting standards. It is another solution to avoid problems of financial statements. Also, we can comply with accounting framework. It's another solution to sort out all your problems. That's why we said in the first semester. If you can remember, last semester we learned financial reporting framework. Anyway, there are several points to be remember. One is, objective of financial statement is to provide information about the main three things, as I told you, about financial position, performance, and cash flows. Hope you can understand all this. I don't want to explain. I'm just running through these. And we had one accounting assumption called going concern. We learned that all other concepts that you learn in the first semester are based on going concern. And also before these two, actually you should understand the importance of accounting framework. Where do you need accounting framework? Basically, accounting framework will provide us reasonable assistance to develop all standards. Also, accounting framework will assist for users to understand financial statements. Also, accounting framework will provide what is called assistance, I told you. Then accounting, actually, we don't have an accounting standard for any kind of scenario, you can apply this accounting framework. Right? Also, accounting the framework will provide assistance to understand qualitative characteristics of accounting information. Then look, qualitative characteristics are there. So this is the only place where we discuss qualitative characteristics of financial state. It means to recognize accounting as good source of information, or to recognize financial statements as good source of information, there are certain conditions to be satisfied. Those are known as qualitative characteristics of accounting information, financial state. There are main two accounting features, the qualitative characteristics. One is relevance and another one is faithful representation. Already I have explained in the first semester. But remember, at least you have to remember that question was there in the last semester exam paper. I asked, write at least one technique or method. Remember, there was a question like that. One method or technique that we can use to comply or protect your qualitative characteristics in financial statement. I gave that question last semester. So relevance, how do you keep relevance? That's why we can do revaluation. Faithful representation. It means you should not have any errors. You have to have neutrality No, so you should not bias when you provide information. So that's why we do. We comply with all accounting standards. Then we can keep faithful representation in financial statements. Then there is another four, as in enhancing qualitative characteristics. Under enhancing qualitative characteristics, there are sort of items called comparability, first one. It means we should be able to compare information. How to keep comparability? We have to provide last year's information. Then only we can keep comparability. Sometimes you can see in annual reports when you do assignments. Hope you have done assignments genuinely. Genuinely. That's right. I noticed whether you have done genuinely. Right? Some people just submitted only formats. That means the thing I gave, as it is, they have submitted in return without filling it. Sometimes they have filled only the first screen. If I scroll down there, nothing. There were that kind of assignments also. But remember, everything I check one by one. Like bulk marking, it's done. But anyway, in the case of comparability, you can see that sometime in some annual reports, there is attachment separately for last 10 years statistical summary. Why? To keep comparability. Verifiability means we should be able to verify information. That's why we account based on source documents. Understandability means we should be able to understand information. That's why again we provide a lot of notes and explanatory notes. Timeliness, we provide information for a year to keep or comply with timeliness principle. That's about C, or the third area in accounting framework. Then we discuss a lot about elements of financial statements. You can remember? I told you a lot of examples in this case. I don't want to explain what is asset liability income expenditure key again. But hope you can remember what is an asset and its characteristics, or even liability and others. So I don't want to explain one by one. And also I told you, there are two conditions to be satisfied to recognize all these five elements in the books of accounts. What are those two conditions? Probability of having economic inflows or outflows, or probable. And the value or the cost should be able to measure reliably. If those two conditions are not satisfied, we will not able to recognize anything as an asset. And there are different measurement techniques of elements: historical cost, current cost, realizable value, and present value. So in last semester, we did a lot on historical cost and realizable value. You can remember in LKS number 2. But this semester, we mostly deal with present value. And also there is something called capital and capital maintenance. That's what we did in accounting framework, right? So then the strength of strength and weakness of accounting framework already I have discussed. No need to discuss. You can remember this case also we discussed last semester. There were no need to discuss. And all these exercises I gave last semester relating to, now this term is account, so financial reporting issues. Now we are going to discuss. Actually, these are the issues now we have. How to recognize all these? Already we have done, therefore I don't want to explain one by one again. Spare parts I did. Purchase of sand, you can remember. Story we discussed. Books, library books, we discussed. Partitioning thing, you can remember. Decommissioning liability. So we will discuss in detail about decommissioning liability with IFRIC number 1. Probably after 5th week, we can discuss. That's all about examples we discussed. But in addition to these, if I ask this kind of examples, now I'll add some more examples. Let's say now one student came to me last week and asked this kind of question. This kind of look, financial reporting issue. Good example. Right? Example is, there is hotel company. It means there is a company who is running a hotel. Right? Actually, that student gave me two stories. Now look, the way that we find financial reporting issues. Right? He was working as audit trainee in an audit firm. But he told me, the company he was auditing bought a new hotel which is close or adjoining to their existing hotel. Let's say there is a hotel here, the operating one. There is Next Land. Or Next Land had a hotel. It was sold. Since they had excess cash, they just bought it. Understand? Then by the year end, that newly bought hotel was not started for their operations, was not open for their operations. Still it has with the same condition that they bought. Understand what I said? A hotel operating company, they bought a new hotel which is very close to the existing hotel, but they just closed down everything there. They didn't do any renovation work. Everything closed and kept it as it is. They don't use that new hotel for their income generation purpose. Now the question, can you recognize that newly bought hotel as an asset? Yes or no? Anyway, you bought a hotel. Therefore, very clear it is an asset. It is not my question. What standard should be applied? That is a good point. They bought a new hotel, but it is fully vacant now. They don't do any business. They just keep it as it is there. Mukut karanna, it is there. Become haladamathin. At least they don't use it for car parking. What asset is it for the company? What standard should be applied in that case? Anybody who is online? What do you think? Can you recognize it as PPE as we learned in the first semester? Property, plant and equipment. Yes. It's an asset, very clear. You just check whether all these conditions are satisfied. All satisfied. You write it in the balance sheet, can you recognize it as property, plant and equipment? That is my question. Anybody online? Now, Chintani is there, Pereira, Sundarilingam, Tarash. Excellent. Nobody is there. I'm not sure that they are there. How many people do accounting stream? How many students? I don't know. Actually, I couldn't check it. Total 72 out of that. Why is it? I didn't know. More than around 40%. 40. Out of 72. 72 people are there, but 50 something now submitted assignments. How many people are there? Right. Total. Anybody, can online people hear me? It seems like no, isn't it? Okay. What do you think? Did you get my question? Now this is financial reporting issues. So then we are going to talk about issues. In first semester, if you can remember, I told you, if any company is running a private zoo, if any company, yes, can hear you, have to answer for the questions also. Right? If any company, if private company is running a private zoo, if animals are there. Any animals are there? Can animals recognize as an asset? I told you yes, it's so. You can remember I told you a story related to elephants. I told you those elephants can be recognized as an asset. Now, like in this story, what I told you, a company who is operating a hotel bought another hotel, but they kept it closed. They didn't open it for business. So then can you recognize it as property, plant and equipment? That's my question. The point is, it is not allowed to recognize as part of property, plant and equipment. It is an asset, it's true. But it is fully vacant. You don't use it for income generation process. Then when you ask from the board of directors what they said in the real story, they said, actually, the adjoining land was sold, land and the hotel was sold by those owners. We had enough money, therefore we just bought it. But still, we don't have any intention to do something in the future. We have to consider it in the future. In that case, it means they just bought it without having any intention to use it for commercial something, commercial work. In that case, you have to consider this as investment property. It is not coming under property, plant and equipment. So it's a very important point. Now, mostly people will struggle and they will have a lot of problems to decide which standard should be applicable. It is kind of big gray area in accounting. So look now, I just ran through this accounting framework thing just to make sure whether you can recall all this knowledge. But important part, you have to think what standard should be applicable. That's a very simple example, another one. In the previous case, at least if the new one was used for car parking, at least, then you can consider it as property, plant and equipment. Otherwise, you have to use it as investment property. Very simply now, if I take another one like this, let's say now, currently this building fully utilized by the Faculty of Commerce and Management Studies to deliver lectures. Saturday, Sunday, fully you can see all halls are full. Why? We earn revenue for the university. Let's assume. From next month onwards, university will take a decision to stop all these lectures inside this. And they will decide to fully rent out this. Now what will happen? From next week onwards, can you recognize this as part of property, plant and equipment of this company, university? Can or can't? Currently, anyway, we are using these four lectures. It means it is coming under PPE, property, plant and equipment. But the problem is, if you decide to rent it out to outsiders without conducting classes inside this building, what we have to do? Is again should be recognized as part of investment. Till next month, we can recognize this as property, plant and equipment. After that, we have to classify it as investment property. Why? We have decided to rent it. Mostly in investment properties, we take two kind of properties. One is, we call it actually lands and buildings, which we purchase with the intention of earning rent income or with the intention of having capital gain. Right? If you buy a land or building only, if you buy any land or building with the intention of reselling with the capital gain, means capital appreciation, or with the intention of renting out, then what will be? Those are not part of property, plant and equipment. We have to recognize it as a separate class of assets. We'll discuss investment property later. Call investment property LKS 40. Understood, people online? It's kind of a new point. mostly people do not have enough understanding what standard should be applicable. That's a good point I mentioned. Right, then next one. I'll take another example. Let's say like this. There's a company. Let's assume it's a pharmaceutical or drug selling company. Drug selling company, but their main business is selling drugs. Let's assume there's a company called X Company. The main purpose is to sell drugs, right? So then what they do is, these are examples, huh? They buy a machine under finance lease. They buy a machine under finance lease and install it in a hospital. Understand? Let's assume I am the drug manufacturer or drug seller. What I do, I'll buy a machine from a leasing company under lease terms and I fix it in a hospital. Private hospital. According to the agreement between the drug manufacturer and the hospital, at the end of the lease period, asset ownership will be transferred to the hospital. Understand? These are financial reporting issues. Then who will pay the all lease terms? The drug seller will sell all lease terms. Understand? Then I'll summarize facts again. Drug manufacturing and selling company will buy a machine under finance lease and it was established or fixed in a private hospital. At the end of the lease, all lease the lease installments will be paid by the drug manufacturing company to the lessee. And at the end of the lease period, the ownership of the asset will be transferred to the hospital. Usually what happens? At the end of the lease period, ownership is transferred to the person who is paying lease terms. Understand? And also, the drug manufacturing company has sole authority or power to remove or relocate the machine from that particular private hospital. If I need what I can do, let's say after 2 years, I decided to take it off from the private hospital and I fix in another hospital. That power is with whom? With the drug manufacturing company. Now, who should recognize the asset? There are three parties involved. Understand? Who are the three parties? One is the leasing company. Second one, drug seller. Third one, private hospital. Who should recognize the asset? Took the point. Understand? We are talking about financial reporting issues. It's kind of not that much clear, complex. Who should recognize this as an asset? Which part? People who are in online can connect with us. Hospital. Who is better? Drug seller. Or leasing company. I'll further explain this with leasing later. leasing company can't recognize this as an asset because this is under finance lease. Controllability is not with the leasing company. They have only legal ownership. According to substance over form concept, to recognize an asset, legal ownership is not essential. We need to have controllability. Leasing company doesn't have any controllability of the asset. They have only the legal ownership. So therefore, they are not allowed to recognize it as an asset. The drug seller, he pays all installments. But he doesn't use the asset directly. Therefore, is there an economic benefit earned by drug seller as a result of this asset? Why not? It's there. What they do usually in practice, the machine is established in the hospital and their drugs should be used in the machine. Understood. So then indirectly what they do, it's an agent in the drug market, pharmaceutical market. They facilitate, they help doctors and everybody. Then doctors will write their the drugs for the press, what is called medicines. So then, indirect, even though asset is not used directly by the drug seller, so they have economic benefits over the asset. Understood? On the other hand, according to the agreement, at the end of the lease period, asset will be transferred to the other side. It is at the end of the lease. Also, controllability is with whom? With the drug seller. Why? They have power to relocate the asset from that hospital to another hospital. Then power over the, or the control over the asset is also with whom? With the drug seller. Therefore, what is our conclusion? Drug seller should recognize it as an asset even though he is not using directly. Understood. And it should be depreciated over 5 years. At the end of the 5th year, drug seller should recognize kind of disposal profit or loss on this asset at the time of transfer. Those are several examples I added, like most of the examples we discussed last time, so they have no need. And mostly we have a small question. Some are going to learn financial reporting issues. Then, on one side, actually, if you are not aware about financial reporting, how can we discuss financial reporting issues? Discuss issues, we should understand financial reporting rules first. So therefore, in this semester, what I try to do, we'll take some theoretical aspects. With that, we will discuss financial reporting issues. Understand? Like you know, big one, not only financial reporting issues, there are something called contemporary accounting issues. What is my contemporary accounting issue? Contemporary accounting issue. What is it? Any example for contemporary account issue? It means every day people are talking about this, but still there is no final solution. Day by day, the sector is improving with comments and the research and all other things contributed by people, the industry and the academic sector. But still it is kind of concept. This therefore we know, we recognize it as part of contemporary. Today we are recent account issues. Recent accounting issues. Still, we don't have hard and fast answers. So, then any example like that? Right. Any example? Corporate governance. Now, anyway, it's a big issue now. Everybody is talking about now. What kind of thing? Good governance practices.
is government also elected like that? Under good governance practices, even though it is so. Now people say they also do, we don't know. But people say the new government also do corruption. It means they also have lack of governance, good governance practices. That may be the reason. Right? So anyway, now corporate governance is kind of good area people are talking about. Likewise, there are a lot of other areas, those are macro level issues. But previously I took several examples. Those are inherently very narrowed areas. Now, in previous examples that I told you, those are issues relating to IAS 40 and IAS 16. Understand? Let me now, if I take example like this, to add the same. Let's assume. This example, I'm not sure whether I told it in the last semester also. There is something called water world there in Calgary. There are fish. Can they recognize those fish as an asset? Probably it should be. It should be. It is an asset. What standard should be applicable? Agriculture. Most people say like that. But it is BP. Why? Look. Let's assume that if you have seen now close to Rampaha, somewhere there. There is a place where they grow these old fish. Fully fishery farm. What standard should be applicable? There you keep all these fish just to earn income by showing them to others. There you have fish for breeding. Right? Oh, we call it, we sell fish there. We sell fish. Here we don't sell fish. We show them to others. So two different purposes. But fish. Whatever you can apply IA 16. The other fish, I told you, go with agriculture. Understood. So that's the difference. Let's say now birds are there, water bird. So then those birds they don't sell. Or they don't have more birds, or they don't like what is called breeding birds. But if you have birds, if you have a place where you sell birds, then it is coming under agriculture. That's a difference, right? So that's the most crucial point I have seen. But anyway, it is that selecting the standard is kind of financial reporting issue. Financial reporting. It's kind of issue. Also, I told you several issues before. Now, fair value still, I think we have not learned the concept. We can learn it later. When we apply fair value, so we have to take market measurements. Very simply, let's assume if I need to fair value of a business, mostly we take the fair value of share price in the market. Market price per share. Do you think that our share market will represent the real value of the business through its market value, market price per share? Probably not. Why? Our market is fully manipulated market. It is fully controlled by several people there. It's true, no? That's a reality, no? Even though people do not accept. That's a reality. It is fully manipulated market. The share prices will not show the real performance of the business. We do next week something called IFRS 2, share-based payment. It means the senior employees are encouraged or motivated by paying a commission based on value increase of a share. We learn how to account for those. When you apply those in our country, all standards are developed in the developed markets. Their share price mostly show kind of proxy for the value addition created by the company to the society. It is kind of proxy. But in our country, it is not so. Even though share price is too high, sometimes company is not performing well. Understand? It is also kind of financial reporting issues. When you take fair value based on market measurements, there may be some problem. Those are very micro level ones. Therefore, we recognize them as financial reporting issues. There is another set of thing called contemporary account issues. Look this one. This is one of the article I have given you. Look, they are in this research article, they are talking about main six contemporary or very broad accounting related issues. Those are not like the issues that I talk. Those are very micro level ones, small ones relating to different standards. Yeah, look, the first one they are talking about is corporate governance. Corporate governance. This researcher, or the author, has recognized corporate governance has major accounting issue. Or we call it contemporary accounting issue. People are talking about this thing everywhere. People are talking about corruptions. And when I talk about corruptions, I can remember one statistic recently. In the world, highest corruptions arise in the Asia, South Asia. It's around 67% from total. Sorry, not corrupt, total, made a mistake. From total corruptions, bribery. If you take the term corruption, it has a lot of several sub areas. All are corruptions. Bribery represents 67% in South Asia. If you take 100 corruptions, 67% come in under bribery. Bribery again, that one? Done. In Asia, the most highest. Other areas, it is not that much, 30%, 40%, 20%, somewhere like that. But in Asia, it's very high. It is based on nations to report nation, issued by IA, Association Certified Fraud Examiners in 2016, this year. So then corporate governance will play a major role to avoid those corruptions. So that's why now you are now new government, they introduce a lot of new rules and regulations. It's good to stop corruptions. It should be. That's a different story now. There is kind of criticism also for them. Something related to this bond story. Now through the co-op committee, then people accept that something has happened. Something has happened. We don't know. But still, their main theme to stop what? Corruption. That's why they talk about good governance practices. So therefore, it is kind of big issue in accounting. But how do you recognize good practices into accounting now? But I feel like there is something called misappropriation of assets. Now, mostly for the previous government, we have criticisms relating to misappropriation of assets. Why? Some physical things they constructed, with those they have taken some money illegally. Or sometimes they have misused government funds. Sometimes they have misused government assets. Those are misappropriation of assets. But look now, bond story, you can't see anything. Only figures taken here and there. Nothing physical. What is that? Something related to accounting aspect, with numbers. If any corruption is done with numbers, not easy to track. But if any road is constructed, people can argue, now construction is going on, somebody can take some money. But bond transaction, bond is not physical something. Those are with treasury funds here and there, transferring. Nobody can see what happened. Therefore, people do not feel. That's a reality. Then people, that's why we say in accounting with numbers, corporate governance is important. That's why people are talking about this very long period. Still, people are developing these different things. But still, we have corporate governance code jointly issued by Chartered of Sri Lanka and Securities and Exchange Commission. They also let down the same, we call it corporate governance code. All companies should follow these guidance to run their business smoothly. It is good for the economy as well, fine. So therefore, in this research article, one macro level accounting issue is corporate governance issue. You read this article, then you can understand further. The second one. Second issue is accounting system and internal control system. If internal control system is weak, anyway, what happens? Our accounting system is not up to the standard. So therefore, it is also kind of issue that we need to focus, and people are trying to sort out this thing time, especially internal auditing will play a major role in this case, right? Then third critical issue is estimations. It's a very common thing. Everybody know. Everywhere in accounting, we make estimates. Next two days, I'll do IFRSs. You will not believe the degree of estimations we use. We will use more accounting estimates in IFRS 2 and IFRS 19. Sometimes you can't imagine how to make this kind of estimates in accounting. So therefore, what are the guidance in what is called accounting report, financial reporting framework? Only one standard we have, LK Sambhi, relating to accounting estimates. But it is not capable enough. So then mostly we do or measure some items or figures with estimates. This kind of inherent problem in accounting. There is another problem. Also, when it comes to estimates and all others, it directly affect to accounting quality. So, therefore, mostly this improving accounting quality, because now you know to produce the main purpose of financial statement is provide information. All this information should have enough quality. And what is about accounting quality? How to keep accounting quality is another question raised by this author in this research article. Also, therefore, it is also kind of accounting issue. And the next one is the fourth area that this author has identified is internal and external audit. Why? Now, sometimes people do not believe auditor statements. There are enough evidence. Inherently, there are some certain scope limitation of auditing. That's why actually we have new area called forensic accounting. We saw something about forensic accounting in this semester on the contemporary accounting issue. Now let's say, very simply, auditor, what auditor does? Auditor will provide an opinion based on information available to him. Let's assume now if you realize that something has happened in this business organization when you do external audit work, what you do? You will consider the implication to the auditor's opinion. Based on that, you will give your opinion. Understand? But auditor will not go and see or examine further about the story. It is not done. You just recommend it to whom? To the management to look after the matter. That is auditor's. Even government auditors, what they do? They just report to the auditor. Auditor General is reporting to whom? To the parliament. He's liable, right? So then he will report. The action should be taken by who? Parliament, and through again, including in the court. So they will take the action. But look now, if you know, very, very simple, like, important story I recently heard the way that the auditor act, and there is another person called forensic accountant. Now in this, since the external auditing and internal auditing is not capable enough to manage today's accounting problems, there is another person involved in called forensic accountant. Who is that? It means, let's say now, if internal auditor, external auditor recognize any red flag, any problematic area in financial reporting, further investigation will be done by whom? Forensic accountants. That's what they do in FCID, you know, what they do. Now, according to audit reports, there are some comments about these items. Everything is reported, but no one has taken any action. This, then what they do? They appoint a separate the body called FCID. What they do? They investigate each of these cases reported by government officials based on some other facts. They further investigate, and they also do not have power to get in custody. What they do? They present those people to whom? To the court. The FCID will report to whom? To the court. They will provide certain information or evidences to prove this, what is called financial crimes, to the court. That is forensic accountants. Will auditor do that? Auditor doesn't provide any evidence to the court to run court trials. But forensic accountant will come and see, further examine, gather evidence and provide it to court. So that's what we call now here. We have big issue related to internal and external audit. But there are all other what is called solutions also. Right? Then fifth one, relationship between accounting and other disciplines. Mostly now people argue accounting just provide information about its statistics. There is no relevance to other departments or division. That's why now currently most people are talking about integrated reporting. It comes, we will do it, integrated reporting also in this subject as one session, part of the session. In integrated reporting, we mainly focus about how to report overall performance of this. I mean, integrated all these relevant sections. So therefore, it is also kind of contemporary accounting. Now look, the biggest one. Sixth critical issue is international convergence. Right? International convergence. What is international convergence? We converted all our accounting standards, or local version of accounting standards into international version in 2000. Yeah, in 2012. Then we converted everything called IFR research. Previously we had SLAs. As I told you the difference between IASS and IFRS. Did I tell you? Now, in this semester, we are going to learn a lot of IASS and IFRS. Now, next week, we learn one IFRS. Following week, we learn one IAS. Then, both are covered by this standard, by the course syllabus. Important ones, not all. Important IFRS and IAS. Then, what's the difference between IASS and IFRS? I think I told you in the last semesters. Anybody who is in online, what's the difference between IAS and IFRS? Set of IASs combined to IFRS. It's true, it's happening now. What's the difference between these two? Actually, IASs were issued before 2001 under IASC, the International Accounting Standard Committee. It's from 1973, as I remember. From 1973 to 2001, world body of providing standards is IASC, International Accounting Standard Committee. Right? International Accounting Standard Committee. It was restructured in 2001 with the name of IASB, International Accounting Standard Board. Understand? So then all new accounting standards are issued by IASB with the label of IFRS. Then look, all IASs that we are talking about came when? Before 2001. Look now, this agriculture standard, it's LKS number 41. Agriculture standard applied in Sri Lanka after international convergence in 2012. But it was issued in 2001. It was the last standard issued to the world. IAS 41, agriculture. After that, there is no IAS. Last IAS issued in 2001, even though we adopted it in 2012. Understand? Now everything coming in the form of IFRS 4. Like you said, it's true. Now recently we have IFRS 10. We will learn it today, this semester, relating to a business combination, IFRS 10, covering some of standards, IASs and IFRS. We have IFRS 9 for financial instruments. IFRS 9 for financial instruments. Previously we had IAS 32, IAS 39, IFRS 7, also replaced by IFRS 9 for new financial instruments. That's what we do in this semester. Look, there are, as you said, there are several locations where they combine set of IASs and issue new IFRs. Now that's the difference, right? Right, we were talking about sixth issue, internationalization or convergence of accounting standards. To come into these PowerPoints, that's what I'm going to talk about here. International convergence of accounting standards. Convergence means adopting one set of standards across the globe. What are the benefits of converting all these local versions into international version? Main thing is we can keep comparability. Also, credibility of information will be increased. Those are the main benefits we have if you go into international convergence. But when it comes to convergence, there are a lot of barriers or problems. What are the barriers to convergence? Look, there are a lot of fighting. Different purpose of financial reporting. Different legal systems are having in different countries. Different user groups are there in different countries and different regions. There are some nationalism and cultural differences. And also, importantly, the last one is very important one actually, lack of a strong accountancy body. Then who will look after the work in their country? We are going to apply the international version. And also, as I told you previously, most of the standards or IASs were developed in developed countries. When try to apply as it is in our country, local developing countries, inherently we have problems. So then those are major problems in IFRS convergence. Therefore, if you are going to learn IFRS, you are trying to apply, there may be some financial reporting issues inside these IFRS. Though some of IFRS problems are addressed by another set of things called IFRICs. Understand? So therefore, in this semester, we are going to cover at least 5-6 IFRICs as well. And overall aspect. Because IFRICs or IFRICs, we discuss some gray areas in IFRSs. IFRICs. IFRICs are addressing some gray areas in IFRSs. So therefore, we will take at least few IFRICs in our syllabus. We take IFRS 1, 15, 17, I have included few, look this up. IFRS 1, 13 for customer loyal program, 15, 17, 4, 18. So those are the IFRSs we are going to cover. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Altogether we have 21 IFRICs. See Kathi. Out of 21, we are going to discuss at least 6 which are important in our practice. Pressing bell example, if I take like this, usually when I buy an asset, what happens? I pay cash and buy the asset. He's told me, I pay cash, buy the asset. Then it's my own asset. Let's say if I need to buy this laptop, I pay cash and buy the laptop. It's very easy. But look this kind of example. Let's say if you are working as electricity company, you need to let's say if you are going to buy, if you are going to get electricity connection to your production place, you need to establish a transformer. Understand? As customer, what you have to do? You have to pay for the transformer. Understood? So in your hand, what happens? You pay cash and give the asset back. Right? Who will be the real owner of the transformer? Electricity board. From the electricity board side, what they do? They collect cash from the customer. At the same time, they collect asset. Usually what happens? Usually in normal circumstances, we need to buy an asset. We pay cash and get the asset. In that case, what happens? They get the cash and get the asset. Both are coming in. Otherwise, what happens when we buy an asset? There is outflow, there is inflow. In this case, what happens? There are two inflows. And those are extraordinary cases. Therefore, those kind of things are discussed in IFRS. Transfer of asset from customers, IFRS 7. Understand? So then you can understand in a solution for problems in international convergence or some IFRSs. Actually, we have set of other things called IFRSs. Also, we have some SIC, another set of things called standard interpretation committees. Very simply, I have example here. This 8 thing. Let's say if any company is producing a website, if any company is producing a website, how to account for website? Where is the guidance? There is no standard which will provide us guidance to account for websites. But there is something called SIC 30. It provides us guidance on accounting for websites. Understand. So therefore, in financial reporting, we are talking about financial reporting issues. As part of introduction, what I need to say you, in IFRS or financial reporting, not IFRS, financial reporting, we have four main branches. What are the four main branches? We have sort of IASs, we have sort of IFRSs, we have sort of IFRICs, and we have sort of ISICs. Now in all four, we need to take financial reporting, but here the subject is financial reporting issues. How to discuss issues in financial reporting. Got it? So therefore, now with this point, I can wind up the introduction session, and I'll discuss the second part, human resource aspect, after break. But anyway, what I need to say you, as first 1 hour and 15 minutes that I spent to give kind of broad understanding about financial reporting issues. I told you several examples for financial reporting issues. Also, I told you several examples with the research article relating to macro level contemporary accounting issues. But mainly we try to focus in this syllabus major financial reporting issues plus some contemporary accounting issues, of course. But at the same time, we need to learn some reporting guidance given by different IASs, which is important ones, and IFRSs, IFRICs, and SICs. That's our whole syllabus this semester. Look, we learn something about integrated reporting, employee benefit, share-based payment, creative accounting, forensic accounting, and especially financial instruments. Whereas, very simple question, since we learned intangible last semester. Shares. If you buy shares for another company, can you recognize it as intangible? What do you think? If you buy shares of another company, can you recognize shares as part of intangible? What do you think? Can you recognize shares, investment in shares as part of returns? What do you think? People who are online very silent today. I don't know whether they can hear me properly. Let's see, Chintani wrote something. No. Why? If you say no, now you have to say what is reason. Why? Mostly we will say it's investment. No, it is not the reason. To recognize something as intangible in accounting, it should be in non-monetary form. Can you remember last semester we did? When you define intangible, I told you, it is non-monetary asset without having physical substance. Non-monetary. Monetary ones are not recognized as part of intangible. That's why we don't recognize it as intangible asset. But it's part of investment, which is coming under financial instruments that we learn IFRS 9. Understand? Right. So with that, we will wind up this introductory session. I spent only 1 hour. Basically, I wanted to give you kind of brief overview about financial reporting issues. Accordingly, I told, if you can remember, I started with the financial statements or accounting process. In accounting process, we have input, process and output. I told you all inputs are affecting two elements. Based on elements, we have 5 double entries. Based on 5 double entries, we have complete set of financial statements. That's the main output of accounting. In this main output of accounting or financial reporting, we have several issues. I told you some solutions to overcome those issues. Also, I told you some common solutions for all financial reporting issues. Make the disclosures as possible as you can. Also, I told you to comply with financial reporting standards. Also, I told you to comply with accounting framework. Those are three common guidance available to overcome financial reporting problems or inner problems of financial state. Then I told you accounting framework will provide us good assistance to overcome most of the financial reporting problems. Because if you can remember, I told you last semester also, accounting framework is like a foundation of a house. This is important. And most of the problems we can overcome based on the foundation for accounting framework. Then we came into a accounting framework and I gave you a set of examples from accounting framework. And also we learned several examples for financial reporting issues. I told several stories like hotel story and the leased asset story and some bird stories. The main crucial point is selecting the suitable standard. You have to focus on that. And thereafter, we learned about macro level accounting problems. We call them contemporary accounting issues. And we identify 6 types of contemporary accounting issues. Corporate governance issues, internal and external auditing issues, internal control system issues, accounting estimate issues, then international convergence issues. What is missing one? I missed one. Link between accounting with other disciplines. Those are the things we discussed from the introductory session. And I told you several problems in international convergence. When it comes to international convergence, anyway, there are some barriers. You should overcome those. International convergence is good, but the thing is, think twice. This thing already we have discussed in last semester, if you can remember. Historical cost versus fair value. Since still we have not learned about fair value, I don't take this thing seriously now. We can talk about fair value later. So with that, we will wind up the introductory session for 1.5 hours. 1.5 hours, already we have spent 1 hour and 15 minutes. And we will have a small break, because I am not well today, that's the reason to have a break. Otherwise, usually, you know, I don't like to give a break. So then we will have 10 minutes or 15 minutes break, and we'll come back discuss about another gray area. It's also kind of contemporary account issue. Now, if I ask, last semester also we learned, we provide training to employees, long-term training for employees. Can you recognize it as an asset to the business, intangible asset? I told you no. Training cost is not intangible. Can you recognize your employees as an asset to organization? Yes. Have you seen that employees are recognized as asset in any financial statement? Have you seen that employees are recognized as an asset in any financial statement? No problem. So that's the question. Now, from the next set of slides, we are going to learn that issue. It's kind of issue. Some people argue human asset is one of the major or the important asset in any kind of business. I'll tell you the reason later. But it is not in my balance sheet or statement of financial position. That means important asset is missed from my financial statement. Then how do you provide information to stakeholders to make their decisions? Understand? So therefore, it is also kind of problem in accounting. Now, next part, we are going to learn how to overcome that. So it means human resource accounting, right? So we will discuss human resource accounting just after the break, and we'll take 10 minutes or 15 minute break. Right, let's start after break. Right, we are going to talk about another important aspect in accounting. It's about we are going to have a discussion whether we can recognize employees as an asset. Right? It is also part of assets. Right, we have already talked about different types of assets in accounting framework. Right? So, hope I have given a Word document in LMS. Relating to human resource accounting, but basically now we discuss a lot of different types of assets. You can remember already we have discussed about tangible assets, intangible assets, then financial instruments we will discuss later, then agricultural assets, inventories, contingent assets, different items. But now look this on the human assets. What are the main differences between human assets and other assets? Mostly other assets have monetary value. This do not have this. Okay. Right. What else? Most of the assets, like you said, physical assets, lifetime is limited. Limited human asset, unlimited. We can't say like that. Anyway, guessing lifetime is quite difficult in the case of human assets. But for machine, if you maintain it properly, we can make reasonable estimate about its useful lifetime. But for a person, even we maintain properly, so you know, moving, everything nice, dressed, everything maintained, on time you take what is called breakfast, lunch, dinner, having 8 hours or more than sleep, everything means may properly maintained, right? No damage at all. Even though that, you are not sure about the lifetime. That's the reality. So therefore there is a case there. Estimation of useful lifetime. We can't say limited, unlimited. Physical asset limited, human asset unlimited. We can't say like that. But guessing lifetime is quite complicated in the case of human assets. But for physical assets, we can make reasonable estimate. That's one thing, yes. Also, you know, human asset, so physical assets are not reactive nature. Why do you say like that? If something is happened to physical assets, those assets will not react to your decision. But human asset, what happened? Human asset is kind of reactive nature. Okay. If you take any decision on human asset, there is kind of reaction. Out of those, one of the major one is not those. There's another one. All physical assets will be controlled by who? When automated machines are there, who has done the automation part? That is by human asset now, right? Operating is done automatically. It's true. But automated part is done by the people. So therefore, we will not be able to use any asset without having physical, so any asset, we will not be able to use any asset without using human asset. Therefore, the most important asset is missed out in our balance sheet. What is it? Human asset. So that is kind of question. Contemporary accountants, you know, people think now, look, in the world, there are a lot of service nature organizations are on the top. Google, and what else? Microsoft is also part of service, and all are world famous brands. But in those companies, mostly the human skill is very valuable asset, but it is not in the balance sheet. What is human asset? Usually, look the differentiator. Human asset is all kind of energies, skills, talents, experiences and creativity and knowledge of people which are capable to produce productive activity. Not only people. What is all energies, skills, talents, experience, everything inside human we call human asset. And human resources. Now the main objective of human resource accounting is to do two things. Actually, we need to look how to value human asset first, and the second one, how to record human asset. Main two questions inside human asset is valuation and recording. How to put numerical value? How do you put the double entry? Even though this the discussion of human resource originated in 1960s, but still, it's only kind of discussion. Merely a concept, but still we are not in a position to finalize it, or we are not in a position to take into books of accounts. Still people argue, still it is valid. Why? I told you several reasons. Human asset is kind of reactive nature asset, not like other assets. Guessing it is difficult, guessing the useful lifetime is quite difficult. Sometime maybe more than physical assets. And human asset actually will control all other assets. Therefore, you all agree, human asset is one of the assets. Now the question, human resources. Why can't we recognize as an asset? Look the definition of assets. And see whether we can match all these conditions in the asset definition with human resources. What do you mean by human resources? All type of energies, skills, energy skills, talents, experience, and creativity. Right? So now let's see. Oh, now, can you detach a person, or a body, and these skills? Skills, talents? Sometimes. Tell me any example. Can you detach my energy, skills, talents, experience, creativity out of my body? Human resources means our body is there. Everything, energy, skills, talents, everything inside this. So the person means human resource. Everything inside this. Understand? Why can't we recognize this body as an asset? First criteria. What is first? You can remember. First condition, does it arise as a result of past transaction event? Yes or no? Arise as a result of past transaction event. Yes or not? To recognize any asset, there should be five conditions to be satisfied. First one, whether it is arise as a result of past transaction or event. What is it? You recruited people. It's under past transaction or event. Whether asset is produced to the organization as a result of past transaction or event, yes or no? Yes, you recruited. Machine also saying no. Machine is produced by somebody, you bought it. Therefore, it's best. Now you have recruited people. I mean, even it's in kind of event. Second. Controllability. Yes. Do you have controllability over assets? Over employees? Yes. But in law, we do not recognize employer is having a controllability over employees. Let's say if you are working as my employees in my organization, I don't have any control over you, even though I sign bonds with you. Vice versa, even I sign a bond, if you need, you can leave the organization. You have rights. Whatever the money you can pay back me, but you leave the organization. Even though I say that you should produce more, you produce more if you don't like. I can't get the work done like that. We have up to certain level, but even husband and wife, we don't recognize one has control over another. Then where is employees and employers? You can understand. So therefore, controllability over employees are not belongs to employer. This kind of question. Third one. There is any future economic inflows? Yeah, it's true. It's fast. Can you measure the cost? Can you measure this energy, skills, talents, experience, creativity of employees? This kind of question. This kind of question. Then we are not sure whether we will be able to measure all these. Measurability for the valuation of cost is a question. The next one. The last one. probability of having economic influence, or whether we need to make sure whether it is probable. The probability is there. We can recognize it as an asset. So then we were talking about criteria to be recognized, to recognize human asset. First one I told you, arise as a result of past transaction event. Second one, controllability is not there. Third one, future economic inflows, yes there. Cost, questionable, whether we can measure everything. Probability, whether it is probable. Probability of having economic inflows. Yes or no? Still we have question on that. Okay. Why? Now, let's say when I recruit people, there should be kind of inflow. I don't know whether they will produce more or less. It's not that much sure. So therefore, usually we say probable inflow is not sure. And so then, two conditions. Anyway, we have to put question marks: controllability and the probability of generating economic inflow. Therefore, we say usually, in accounting terms, human resource is not recognized as an asset, right? But still, people try to discuss and take these human assets into books of account. I told you, there is no special standard to cover this area. But this discussion was started in 1916, right? Still people are talking about this, but no solution. There is no universally accepted solution to recognize human asset in the books of account, right? Now let's see again. There are a set of definitions which are not that much important. You can read it later. I told you, human asset means all kind of experience, talents, energies, skills, and creativity of people that you can contribute for productive activity. That's what we call usually human resources, right? In human resource, mainly there are three aspects. I told you, out of those, two are the questions: how to value, how to account, or how to record. But disclosure part is not a big issue. You can disclose even qualitative stuff. Currently, you can see a lot of disclosures are made relating finance, human assets. Rather disclose it. You see, most of the organizations, they record their skills of employees, number of trainings that they have provided, then all awards and all others given to employees, all welfare facilities given to employees, and if there is any special skills of employees, and number of what is called wins you have from different contexts, everything related to employees will disclose under disclosures. But we practice in our accounting context, we make disclosures related to employees, but we don't account for employees. We don't value, we don't know how to value, and we don't record human assets. In human resource accounting, what we are trying to do is, we are trying to recognize people or employees as an organizational resource, organizational asset, right? These are definitions. I told you, when it comes to human resource accounting, there are main three problems. One, valuation of human asset. Two, recording of human asset. And three, disclosure of human resources. Now, I told you, according to accounting measurements, accounting guidance, we are not in a position to take these human resources as an asset because of this asset definition. Understand? But still, people are arguing on this. We need to take. I already told few reasons. There are more reasons for developing human resource accounting. Why? This is part of human resource management. If you recognize employees as an asset, they will have kind of value. Then there is kind of tendency to stay in the organization. Therefore, people will motivate, self-motivate. You recognize them as an asset. And also, the companies will be able to retain qualified labor force as a result of giving due recognition for them. Also, in traditional balance sheets, we have a problem of overcoming or valuation of intangible assets. It will be kind of solution. Also, if you recognize people as human asset, will we give kind of we discharge our social responsibility towards employees. So, also importantly, this will help to increase the image of companies. That's why most people are trying. People are trying why they need to increase the image of the business by recognizing human resources as an asset. So then finally, as a result of all these what happens, companies will be able to attract good quality new set of employees. So that's why people are trying to recognize, so disclose at least facts to human assets. Got it? The main problem behind this human resource is valuation of human assets. How to value human assets? It's kind of a big issue. When it comes to valuation, there are different approaches given. In the document that I have uploaded into your LMS, it has more than 10 techniques of valuing human resources. But here I have classified everything into two, and I'll discuss at least one method from each category. Right? One method from each category, two methods. Actually, approaches for evaluation of human resources mainly based on monetary measures and non-monetary measures. We are not in a position to take non-monetary measures into financial accounting. Why? Money measurement funds. Everything that can be measured in monetary units only we take in books of accounts. If you can't measure something in monetary units, we are not in a position to take in books of accounts. So therefore, in these monetary methods or measures, we have two methods basically, cost method and value method. Under cost method, you can see historical cost, replacement cost method, and standard cost method. Under value method or present value method, opportunity cost approach or adjusted present value approach or present value approach. You see, at least there are a lot of methods are there, but I'll take at least two methods or three methods to recognize or value human resources. The accounting part is not that much hard. We recognize your human asset as an asset. At least we can recognize it as an asset one side and the other side as deferred revenue. That employee will produce some revenue in the future. Then you can amortize it part by part. But the problem is valuation. You don't, you can't put numerical values into books of account, into human resources. We are not in a position to record. Somehow we should be able to give kind of numerical value, monetary value into this. That's what we are trying to do under validation of human resources. Let's take one bit. Basically, it involves with the capitalization of cost of recruitment, training, familiarization, and development. That's a historical question. This is one of the famous methods. Even we have 10, 12 methods of valuation of human resource. All are having inherent problems. But out of those methods, quite popular one is historical cost approach. Understand? Accordingly, what it says, we are trying to capitalize total cost of recruitment of employees, training of employees, familiarization means orientation, and the development or further development of employees to cater their job. Everything we call cost of employees. All costing incurred for employees from recruitment point or ready for providing service point, we recognize as initial cost of employees. Let's say now if I'm going to recruit you two today, so then I have to pay some money to interview, I have to publish an advertisement, then I have to select you, then I have cost inside it, then I have to train you, then I have to give you a kind of orientation, further training should be provided after selecting, everything. Now only, now it will take a few months. After taking few months, you are ready to work in organizing. Up to that point, everything should be recognized as initial cost of employees. Understand? And what it says thereafter? After recognizing total cost of recruitment, training, and development, and familiarization, it should be amortized annually. How? Over the expected lifetime of individual assets for individuals, for employees. Understand? If any employee leaves the organization before the organization expected service life period, the net asset value to that extent is charged to current revenue. Let's say now I recruit to you two and I spend, let's assume, 500,000 each to recruit you, to train you, to do kind of orientation and everything. Each of you, I spend 500,000. Then my total value will be 1 million. I'll take 1 million as asset, right? Then I assume that you'll stay with me for next 10 years. For 10 years, I have to amortize 1 million, 100,000 each, for each year. Let's say now one left suddenly. This is the balance part on you should be recognized to, yeah, revenue as an expense. That means against the revenue. Against the revenue. Understand? We do so, what are the problems inside this? Advantages of this. Now, easy to compute and easy to understand. Everybody will feel like it's quite fair. Why? It goes with matching concept. I don't recognize total recruitment cost of employees as an expense. I recognize it as an asset and amortize over user lifetime for the working people. Look, the third one, the relevant cost can be obtained from the accounting records. Yes, right. I know the amount of money I spend on these employees to recruit you, to train you, your orientation, to develop you. Therefore, those figures are there. Also, this complies with historical cost concept in accounting. Look, I recruit you, I recruited based on my historical cost. When I buy a machine, what happens? In a machine, from purchasing point, usable condition, everything will be recognized as initial cost. If so, why can't I recognize the total initial cost of employees as an asset? So therefore, there are pluses or advantages of this. Understood? But look, there are some inherent limitations of this. What are the inherent limitations? It provides the measurement of cost, not the value. I spend 500,000 to train you, recruit you, develop you, and orientation of people. Is it your value? Means the value of this employee is 500,000. Is it? No. Value means human resource means what? Energies, skills, talents, experience, all capabilities that you have. But I spent only 500,000 on you. Only the last one, let's assume. Then where's the experience, talents, energy, skills, everything acquired before that? Is it equal to 500,000? No. So therefore, it says we are not accepting the method. Why? It just shows the monetary value of recruitment. It is not the value of human asset. Understand? So therefore, people say this method is not so. Also, it creates problems when we amortize over the period. Usually what happens, if I recruit you by spending 500,000 each, it doesn't matter even though we recognize it as an asset. The time, what happens with your experience, skills, your value? It should be. But what happens according to this method? What I do? I take 1 million as an asset. Over the period, I write off part by part. Then what happens? Well, it goes down. With experience, energies, and talents that you acquire step by step, day by day, year by year in my organization, what happens to your value? It goes down. Real value is increasing while the accounting value decreases. Therefore, this kind of big criticism. Another problem. If you amortize so, like you agreed previously, how should I decide the lifetime of my employees? Even though I recruit today, the next day that employee will die. How do I know? Possible. Sometime one will left. How do I know? So we can't guess it. Sometime even though we don't expect, he will stay till the death, till the retirement. So therefore, guessing the lifetime of an employee is not that much easy. As a result of all these, people say historical cost method does not valid method. Understand? There is another method called replacement cost. And what is replacement cost approach? It considers the cost incurred in replacing the employee with its substitute having the same efficiency and experience. Let's assume. If I need the value of employee today, what I should do is, what is the amount of money that I need to incur to replace you by employing another person with same level of capacity and same level of experience? That's what we call replacement. How can I find? Now, basically, there are two types of replacements in this case: personal replacement and positional replacement. That means I should find suitable person for the person currently an employee. Also, matching with the employment post. We should match the post. That's what we call positional replacement. And also for the person, same capacity. Can you find a person like that? If I need to replace you, can I find a similar person to you? It's not quite obvious. So we are not in a position to find it like that. This is what we call personal replacement. What happens here? Then it will be the main question in this case, replacement cost approach. Even though it's kind of concept, we will not be able to find a suitable person who can match with same level of capacity and skills. So therefore it's kind of question. On the other hand, we have question how to put numerical value. Let's say now I'm going to replace you by X mistakes. If I spend 30,000 to replace you, 30,000 is a cost. Final question. There's another method called opportunity cost approach. What is opportunity cost approach? It means in this method they have advocated competing bidding prices. It means, let's say like this. One employee who is working in one division should be demanded by another division. They should offer bids. That bid value will be the employee's value. Not that much better. Compared to these two methods, what is the fair method? Historical cost is little fair compared to these. These are like fully artificial methods. Right? So then, let's say the question in this. Oh, yeah. It means the opportunity cost of an employee or group of employees is one department is calculated on the basis of bids by other departments for those employees. Now, good example, let's say if there is an accountant, marketing department will put any bid on account. Okay. Therefore, in this method, what happens? The more significant disadvantage of this method is it does not consider these employees as an asset who are not scarce. Let's say you are a smart, qualified, fully qualified, double qualified accountant. You are expert in accounting. Do you have any alternative demand? Other people will not request you. You have only demand from the accounting department. Understand? So therefore, people who don't have the multi-skills will not have any value. But is it correct? No, it is not correct. So therefore, we assume that this method does not that much. The next method or the final method that I am going to discuss is present value method. Present value method or present value approach. What is present value approach? It means we are trying to take salary as good proxy, employee salaries as good proxy to value human assets. We are going to value human assets based on their future expected salaries. What kind of good method compared to other methods? Historical cost, anyway, we had some problems. But little okay, seems like okay. This method was so good now. What we are trying to do, let's say, I recruited you too. Then I guess, what will be your future salary until the retirement? Let's assume I have only two employees. Both are in the same age. Let's assume it is 30. 30. So let's assume it is 40 now. Not 40. Anyway, let's say now both are in the age of 40. You will retire at the age of 60. Then there is 20 years. I guess what will be your next year, next 20 years salary? Sure, it will grow up. Based on growth in salary, I take the present value of all expected future salaries. It will be your value. One method, look, it's kind of a smart way of thinking. After doing so, what we have to do? Okay. Value should be amortized over expected usage life. There is an inherent problem. What is it? Value comes down hereby. Understood? Let's see how it do. In present value approach, limitation. Before that, we'll see this question thereafter. Assume that total number of unskilled employees in the age group between 25 to 34 in the manufacturing concern is 500, and the future average earnings per year per employee is expected to be as follows. Discount rate is also given, 10%. What it says now? Now all the current employees all are in the age of 25 to 34. Right? Now they expect that the current salary level will be 4,000. From 35th year to 44 year, they have taken 5 years slack. They assume that average earnings per year will be 5,000. These are small figures just to understand the concept. Maybe 5 million. Right? Then 45 to 54 years of age, what is your annual salary? 6,000 and then after 5,000. How do you take the present value of this? 4,000 per year for next 10 years. Then we have taken discount effect. 1 divided by 1 plus R, R means 0.1. E to the power 10. Then it will be 1 minus 1 divided by accumulating discounted factor formula. 1 divided by 1 plus R is the power n divided by R. Understand? 1 minus 1 divided by 1 plus R is the power n divided by R. Okay? So that is what we call accumulated discounted factor formula. You don't want to learn now, you'll be learning later. The value is 4,000 into that, 24,000 something. Then from 20, if you can remember, from age of 35 to 44 years, it means from currently, from 11 years to 10 years, from next 11 year to 20th year. Understand? Currently, all are at the age of 25. 25 to 35, it's 10 years. From 11th year to 20th year, another 10 years. Then 5,000 into, how to take the current discounting factor for that period? You take first the 20th year discounting factor, it is 8.514 accumulated one, minus first 10. Why do you say this? Then you will take the balance 10. Understand? You take first 20th year accumulating discounting factor. From that, you subtract the first 10. Then you get balance. So likewise, we have calculated discounting factor, and the present value of all these will be present value of n. Got it? Right. So then look. What are the limitations of this? There are some internal limitations of this method. Valuation of human resources is not determined by salary. It is not valid. If salary is low, there are some employees, they will get small salary, but they work hard. So their working capacity is very big. So therefore, every time salary is not accepted as good proxy for the value of the work done by those employees to the organization. Right? And also we know salary is not constant over the period. But we got it as kind of growing salary over the next 10 years, but it is not constant. It is not practical. Annually, what happens? Salary will be changed. Sometimes even quarterly, we don't know. And also, it does not consider the possibility that person may leave from the organization before the death or retirement. In this case, I assume that you will retire with me for next until the retirement. Maybe next 30, 40 years. It is not possible. Also, during your life or till the retirement, you will get different promotions and different points of time. Those are not considered. Therefore, present value approach also, we have some inherent limitations. Overall, I told you why human asset is important. And in human assets, I told you all kind of energy, skills, experience, talents, and creativity of employees we recognize as human resources. And people argue that human resources are important asset in your organization. Then main two questions is valuation and accounting. Disclosure is easy. And we learn different methods of valuing human assets. Historical cost mainly and present value. And replacement cost and the opportunity cost. Even though we are talking about this thing from 1960s, I told you still it is a concept only. Why? There are some major problems inside this human resource account. I can ask question like this. Even though people are talking about human resources over the last 40-60 years, it is only a concept. Why? Reason. At the very beginning I told you human asset is not combined with the definition of assets. That's the major problem. Also, the valuation of human asset is kind of problem. Not easy. Difficulty of estimating their useful life another problem. How can you estimate accurate useful lifetime of an employee? Very difficult. Another one is, even in law, we do not recognize one person belongs to another. That's why we have human rights. All humans are recognized as individuals. Even we marry another person, we are not belongs to others. So that's the reality. In law, it is not recognized. Right? So those are the major problems to recognize human resource in accounts. Therefore, over the last 30, 50 years, you're talking about human resource as an asset. Everybody agree that it is very important. Why do you say it is very important? It is reactive nature asset. It controls all other assets. And this is the most important asset in organization. But still, it is only a concept. You will not be able to practice it. Understood? So that's all about human assets. And finally, we realize that it is not possible to recognize human asset in itself. Right? So with that, we will conclude the discussion of human resources. Importantly, you should remember why we can't recognize human resources in good sense. I told you there are several reasons. Right? So then with this, we will wind up the today's session. I am not actually well today at all. It's quite difficult to talk. In the morning also I had a lecture. So then I'll cover this time anyway, somehow within next couple of things. But I just ran a little fast today. I wanted to cover this part. The human resource is easy concept anyway. Concept wise, it is not a big one. So you can read it even understand. Right? So it is not a big deal. But basically, from the before the break, what I did, I wanted to discuss something about like which presentation you are talking about? I think human resource presentation. Anyway, even I do not upload this thing, everything is inside the document because I prepared my presentation based on the article. Anyway, I'll upload it, doesn't matter. I'll upload this the presentation also into LMS. You'll have small elaborative nature question from human resource. If you can remember in first semester what we did. I did revision question. This time also we do set of revision questions, but we don't have that much of time this time. Last time the content is small. This time content is very big. It's two times than last time. Content is very big. Therefore, I don't think that we will have at least two sessions to do or discuss revision questions. We'll have probably one session to do kind of model paper. But remember, at the end of every week, I summarize this thing. Today we did introduction and the human resource, two things. Qualitative nature things as well as quantitative things, both are there in this syllabus. Some are qualitative, that's why now, today actually, I did purely qualitative part. Now next week I do IFRS 2 before the break. And after the break, I'll take another aspect, maybe creative accounting. IFRS 2, we need to do calculations. So what I do usually, I take part theoretical thing plus the calculation part. Each day we do something like that. So you have not only one topic for a day. We have several topics for a day. Then today I did kind of introduction part, kind of full technical. And thereafter I came into human resource, kind of only concept or something. Every day we do something like that. Also, I forgot to tell you. Assignment thing I didn't tell you. This time we have two assignments. Both are individual. We will give you, is it essential to have MCQ? If I need, I will give only one assignment. Here the work is easy. So I prefer to have at least online presentation or mostly people, at least one person for a day. I will check how many people we have, otherwise I can't. If it is less than 30 people, I can take two presentations for a day. Only 10 minutes. 10 minutes presentation on different. Any article that you like. Any contemporary accounting issue you like. You can discuss. But I can give you marks. Online marks. Possible? No? I can make a schedule. It is less than 30 students. Otherwise, I don't. No time. Otherwise, I have to take presentation on the lecture. Here you have one essay, group assignment number 2. Explain how fair value is used as a measurement attribute in IFRS and critically evaluate the contribution that fair value make the fair presentation to the financial statements. You have to write 1500 word essay on the topic. Easy enough. Now you can find facts. You have internet source. Find facts and write. Right? Then all what is called guidance argument. Right? Oh, without having an online test, I can give, instead of this, I can give you another work. Individual presentation on that, is it? Good. Oh, online test. What do you like? Online test on that. Okay, we'll see. Anyway, we'll see it later. Focus on assignments also. Then for the first semester work, I have already given assignments. If you have any clarification or any doubt, or if you are not happy about your results, or if you have done any mistakes, sometimes some people upload a documents, it's quite difficult to find because there are some old drawbacks also. It was not cancelled. If you have any doubt or any clarification, you contact me within next week. Then I'll do rectifications because still I have not finalized marks for the final exam. Before finalizing final exam marks, I have rights to change or customize assignment marks. So therefore, please inform your allegations before finalizing final marks. Right. Thank you, and again, we'll see next week, Saturday.